Welcome to this class on Neuroscience of Human Movement. So in this class, we'll discuss a specific disorder of basal ganglia, that is Parkinson's disease. One particular model of Parkinson's disease and whatever little pathophysiology of Parkinson's disease that we know about. So in this class, we'll discuss the rate model of Parkinson's disease and pathophysiology of Parkinson's disease. So essentially, we discussed. So, in the last class, we discussed the importance of MPTP treated animals in understanding the pathophysiology of Parkinson's disease. A huge consequence of animal models in understanding Parkinson's disease has actually come from studies of MPTP treated primates, right. So, what has happened in these cases is that an artificial degeneration of the dopaminergic pathways is caused due to the effect of MPTP on the substantia nigra pars compacta. What was then found was that this led essentially to an increased inhibition at the thalamocortical level, at the output level here. At the output level, essentially what was found was an increase in inhibition, an increase in the excitation going from the subthalamic nucleus to the GPA. Let us remember that this is an excitatory pathway, right. Let us remember that the subthalamic nucleus globus pallidus internal pathway is excitatory, right. Its neurotransmitter is glutamate. Turns out that the activity of the direct pathway is diminished or reduced. Because of this reason, there is a net inhibition at the VAVL thalamus, essentially leading to a reduced amount of excitation at the cortex, right. So, this was found, or essentially what we mean by increased, diminished, reduced is the firing rate of the neurons in this circuitry, right. So, the firing rate is increased, not the number of neurons. So, this has then come to be called as the famous or the so called rate model of Parkinson's disease. Fortunately, this model is able to explain a whole lot of data on patients. However, this model has its limitations though. So, there are several cases where this model cannot explain specific pathophysiology. So, here is data from imaging that shows in a control subject the uptake of dopamine inputamine, whereas in a particular asymptomatic twin whose other twin is having Parkinson's disease. There is reduced uptake of dopamine inputamine. 5 years later, this particular patient develops symptoms, this particular patient has symptoms, and you find very little activation of the inputamine, right, due to this. When this is when compared with this control, right. So, essentially the control, the activity is much higher. This is actually data from Brooks and colleagues, right. Essentially, what happens in Parkinson's disease? What are the various things that happen in Parkinson's disease? Well, at least there are three specific reasons. One is oxidative dysfunction or oxidative modification. Second is mitochondrial dysfunction. And third is protein degradation. So, note all these three are interconnected with each other. So, you see there are specific reasons why one is connected with two, as in oxidative modifications and mitochondrial dysfunction are connected in a two-way street, and mitochondrial dysfunction and protein degradation are also connected, and protein degradation and oxidative modification are also connected, right. Essentially, some of these causes, for example, MPTP, those that are in green, for example, are actually environmental causes. Some of these causes, such as those in purple here, are actually genetic, and those that are in blue are specific to the particular organism, right. Actually, what is going on is an interaction between all these separate factors leading to specific symptoms that are now diagnosed as Parkinson's disease. It is not that each particular thing causes by itself. There is an interaction between these particular causes. Together, they cause the outcome, which is the disease or the pathology, right. Some of these things are very well understood. Each of this refers to a specific phenomenon that has been understood, right. 1, 2, 3, 2, 12, each of this is a phenomenon that has been relatively understood, well understood. However, the interaction between this and what are the exact details are still remaining to be understood. So, there is still a lot of scope for improvement of our understanding of this particular disorder, right. That kind of understanding usually results from recording of neurons from specific regions in the basal ganglia, right, in this case. So, electrophysiology recording from patients undergoing surgery and from animal models, what has been found is that the particular cases that could not be explained by the rate model are explained by oscillations that are either synchronous or not synchronous, right. So, specific oscillations or synchronization between oscillations in different regions in the indirect pathway are believed to be at least one more source of information that could help us understand the pathology better, right. In particular, alpha and beta frequency oscillations in the basal ganglia inhibits the higher gamma frequency oscillation in the cortex. So, it is this inhibition that causes bradykinesia, slowness and akinesia, lack of movement. What is also believed to be true is this phenomenon of rebound bursting that is caused due to extensive GABAergic activity, right, right, within the basal ganglia activity, especially between the input and output. Most of the connections are GABAergic, medium spiny neurons are GABAergic, other interneurons are GABAergic, except the neurons from the subthalamic nucleus, which is glutamatergic, most other outputs are GABAergic, right. So, this interplay between GABAergic neurons somehow cause a reset, a sort of a reset that probably affects the motor circuit. This phenomenon is called as rebound bursting. I am leaving the details for you to read, but this is called as rebound bursting. So, in summary, what we have seen is the important role of dopamine in Parkinson's disease. Essentially, the rate model of Parkinson's disease, in the absence of dopamine, what happens is that the indirect pathway becomes more active and the direct pathway becomes less active, essentially leading to an increased inhibition at the thalamocortical level, right, and the pathophysiology of Parkinson's disease, right. So, we discussed the pathophysiology that there are at least three different but interacting causes. These are oxidative modifications and mitochondrial dysfunction and protein dysfunction. So, these three things interact with each other to result in the group of symptoms that is called as Parkinson's disease. A lot more remains to be understood. So, unless and until we understand the pathophysiology clearly, therapeutic approaches are difficult to develop, right. So, a lot more remains to be understood. The exact molecular mechanisms of many of these things are still elusive as to why, for example, alpha-synuclein continues to build Right? What are the specific causes of that? What are the chain of events that lead to the buildup of this? Right? And all such things are continuing to be mysteries. So, we need to continue to work on this to understand. So, with this, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you very much for your attention.